Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Okay, our passage today is out of the book of John. We're going to look at verses 1 through 14 out of chapter 14. Chapter 14, verses 1 through 14, the book of John. We've been going through the book of John for at least your 51st message. We've been kind of meandering through it over years. Two-thirds, four-thirds of the way done, and here we are, John chapter 14. It's page 1241 in this Bible. It's not a universal page number, so. All right, it says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also, and from now on you know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." Okay, let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this passage this morning that we're going to look at. We thank you, Lord, you speak to us through your word. We thank you, Lord, that your spirit is alive. We thank you, God, that you have something to say to us through your word. And we just praise you for the book of John. We praise you for scripture. And Lord, I thank you that we're here this morning. And may you just open our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit and the power of your word to hear from you this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, when the word comfort comes into your head, what do you think of? Anyone have any word, anything that pops into the head? Yeah. In comfort? Something. You don't have to say it. All right, you're stuck with me. First thing that pops into my mind when I hear the word comfort is dry socks. Okay? Really, from New York City, it's pretty sad. You know, besides public parks, there are no wooded areas. But when I was a boy, there was like one wooded area left by my parents' house, and his house is built on it now, and it's all gone. But through this little wooded area was a little stream, and it was in the wooded area, and it meandered out through neighborhoods, you know, in each direction for miles. This stream had, or it was called the Brook, because it was the Brook, and there was no other water around besides the polluted ocean, but that's another story. It's underground in pipes right now. It's gone. Anything natural in the city, sooner or later, gets the boot. But I'd love to get on that brook and travel when it was ice, and you know, with a friend or two of mine, and we just travel, and it happened every time. You know, you're going out there, and soon enough, you're on thin ice, and you just go under. You get that sinking feeling. I mean, that was the fun of it all. See how far you can go before you fall in. And you know, what happens? Your boots totally submerged. That horrible feeling. It's filling up with water. And then there goes the other foot, and that one's filling up with water. And, you know, there was never a real reason to return home, but no matter how young you are and resilient you might be, you know, freezing wet feet after a while starts to wear on you. And I despise sodden socks. I don't think I'm alone. Who here despises sodden socks? Okay, that's like one of the worst things. Anyway, getting home and peeling off those socks and putting some dry socks, warm dry socks that will actually warm my feet, it's like one of the most comforting feelings in the world. Simple, but very comforting. And you know, stuff like this is, you know, we think of things. We like comfort. And we're so blessed to live in America where there's so many things that bring us comfort, right? We have things that people in the world just don't have, you know. It's not just there's the rich people and then there's us. We are rich. We have good food. We have running water. We have nice furniture. We have warm homes. We have beds and all. The list goes on. And there's a natural desire in us for comfort. And in and of itself, this isn't sinful. We're created in the image of God, and we're wired up to gravitate towards joy. Because joy is, again, in and of itself, a good thing. You know, joy is good. God created good things. We're to be joyful. It gets twisted around. Marketers know this, and they design their advertising around it. You know, we see it all the time. Sometimes we fall prey to it, even if we don't know. You know, you buy this car, and you drive in comfort, right? Things change. Life is good. Buy this device, and life around the home will be much more comfortable. You know, there's comfort fabric softener. And if you use this on your socks, those soggy socks will become very, very, very comfortable. There's comfort in sweets, right? You're traveling around. You're not home anymore, but you're going to be comfortable. One TV broadcaster is offering now the Comfort Channel, right? It's highlighting TV shows that they call them comfort viewings. I didn't look into it. I don't know what. I'm assuming it's stuff from way back, some peaceful stuff. But anyway, so on one hand, we live in the greatest country in the world with the greatest comforts offered. Yet, people as a whole, are we a comfortable country or nation? I mean, anxiety is on the rise. Depression is up. You know, the stress of life in a fast-paced technological world is just pushing things, you know, in a way that it's really not too peaceful. You know, life is filled with tough times, you know, and there's always this book to fix discomfort, to find some peace in it all. Online, you go online and you look to how do you find comfort, and there's pages and pages of information, lists of solutions. Do this to get comfort. Watch your favorite TV show. Take a long walk. Take a nature walk. And some of these things are a good idea. And then you could walk through the woods when dealing with stress. And, you know, stuck on electronic devices for a long time. It's a good thing. You can have to feel your blood pressure drop each step you take. Reading a good book, they say that'll bring you comfort. Some days, take a hot shower or take a hot bath. Baking a cake. Others say eating a cake brings comfort. And there's the ultimate, baking the cake with all those soothing smells and then eating it, right? That's comfort to the max as you're waiting for it. Take a drive, coloring. There's something to coloring. I know our adult coloring books becoming, they start to make them more and more, you know, I think it's something soothing for some people to just doodle with art and, you know, getting exercise, you know, playing or petting your dog or cat, you know, the list goes on. But all these things, it goes much deeper because there's something missing inside of us when we're looking for comfort. We're always looking for satisfaction. And often people can't get that and they turn to destructive habits. And again, they're trying to somehow get comfortable. You know, there's drinking, there's drugs, there's other unhealthy lifestyles. You know, the bottom line is that we desire comfort, and that comfort can be quite elusive. You get it for a little while, you know, it just keeps leaving us. And to this reality, once again, Scripture speaks. It speaks the truth that this world, because it's a sin-scarred world, is packed with all sorts of troubles and trials. And therefore, the problems of this life, the troubles, the trials, the things that make us so uncomfortable, they're dealt with in the Bible head-on. Again, the Bible is a book of reality, right? It talks about another world and our eternal God, but it speaks to us of reality. You know, it takes place in real history with real people that we can relate to. Unlike, say, the Book of Mormon, which speaks of people that never existed, or ancient Greek mythology, which spoke of otherworldly false gods, the Bible is attached to the real world and real people, and therefore it speaks to reality, a reality in which people of all ages always face hardship and long to be comforted. It's not just us. The long book of Job, which was probably from about 4,000 years ago, speaks of Job. He was a man who was no stranger to suffering and was looking for comfort. This is what he had to say about life. How frail is humanity? How short is life? How full of trouble? Carson, can you get that up? Hopefully. All right, thank you. One of his friends, Eliphaz, has this to say: people are born for trouble as readily as sparks fly up from a fire. I mean, this is life. The Bible speaks to it. It isn't some fantasy book. The prophet Jeremiah lamented, "Why did I come forth from the womb to see labor and sorrow, that my days should be consumed with shame?" This is Jeremiah's take on life. Knowing that his followers would face worries in the sin-scarred world, Jesus said to them, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble." And again, that fake Christian message you might hear on TV that, you know, put your trust in Christ and just name it and claim it and everything's great and wonderful. And, you know, Jesus says, you know, each day's got its own trouble. Jesus also put it bluntly in John 16:33, where he says, "In the world you will have tribulation." Okay, so there. The Bible speaks to these things. But praise God, he doesn't leave us there. The blessed promise of Scripture is that our Lord is the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation. Our Lord says in Isaiah 51:12, "I, even I, am he who comforts you." Our God is a God of comfort who wants to bring us comfort. The Lord comforts his children, and he comforts us because he is compassionate and he is gracious. It tells us in Exodus 34:6 and 7, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin." You know, at salvation, so much happens in a person. When a person repents, when they change their mind and from following whatever, they turn to Jesus, believing in his glorious work on the cross, that Jesus took the penalty for our sins upon himself, that we're sinners and we're in need of cleansing from our sins. That's the only way we can enter into his perfect and holy presence. When a person puts their faith in Jesus Christ, that he died for them, that he rose from the dead, they're saved. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." Jesus says in John 6:47, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life." When a person puts their trust in Jesus, they're saved. This is the initial and most important comfort that comes to a believer. And this is a comfort that the world does not know. Okay, again, the born-again believer has this comfort. We will one day have eternal bliss in heaven, no matter what goes on. That's comforting. We know we have this assurance. Isaiah 25:8 speaks to this, where it says, "He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces." This is what our future looks like, our eternity. Revelation 21:4 talks of the believer's eternity in a perfect, it's perfect peace. And we're with God, we're with Jesus himself forever. It says in Revelation 21:4, giving us a little snapshot of what it's like. He says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Imagine living with no pain, no sorrow, no crying, no sin, no anything. So we have that comfort, an eternal comfort in the Lord. But not only that, we have the comfort of the Lord's presence now. When we believe, the Lord is with us now in our trials and in our difficulties. That's a beauty and a blessing. We don't just get eternal life, we have eternal life. The Lord is with us now. In that most famous Psalm 23, David writes, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." God walks with us through the difficulties. In Psalm 86, David proclaims, "You, Lord, have helped me and comforted me." Paul, when in a trial, wrote about the Lord's help in his situation, saying, "God, who comforts the downcast?" The downcast. Things were going south. Life was rough. But God was there. It comforts. Not just a future comfort. It's a comfort we have now because we have his presence. As believers, we have God's word to comfort us. You know, it convicts us. It can be frightening. We know what happens when we read God's word. And as believers, we read it, and sometimes with it, something's got to change. It convicts of sin. But God's word brings comfort. The Psalms are filled with people crying out to the Lord in distress. Psalm 119:50 says this: "This is my comfort in my affliction. Your word has given me life." That's what the psalmist David says. You know, your word. We have truth from God speaking to us. We find comfort in God's word. As believers, we have the Holy Spirit living in us. Jesus tells his disciples about the coming Holy Spirit in John 14:16, a couple of verses past where we are right now in our passage. Jesus says, "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever." And that helper is the Holy Spirit. These things bring comfort. We have God with us. living in us. That word helper, parakletos in the Greek, can be translated as comforter. So we have this comfort, we have God's Spirit in us. We see the early church receiving comfort by the Holy Spirit that indwelt them. In Acts 9:31, another book we're going through, we just see there's all sorts of persecution against the church. They're spread out, kicked out from their homes, all sorts of problems. Life is rough. It says in Acts 9:31, it says, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied. In the midst of life falling apart, being booted away from their homes, having to move far away, they have God's Spirit in them and there's comfort. You know, the Holy Spirit is with this church today. We have God's Spirit with us, living in us, and what comfort we have from the Lord. And here we are in John chapter 14. This is the night before Christ's death. Right? He's going to the cross the next day. And Jesus, who he's going to face a shameful death on that cross. He's going to bear our sins and take the wrath of God upon himself. Yet we see that Jesus is not speaking about his own ordeal. He's instead speaking about bringing comfort to his disciples. They're about to have their lives shattered. If we're looking at this not in the eternal perspective. And they're like us. They're struggling. They're looking at the here and now. Okay? Their leader, they've been following Jesus for 3 years, right? 3 years they're following him around. And their leader, their Savior, the one they left all to follow, because they did, they left everything. They were just following him around. He's going to be brutally murdered. He's going to be gone from them. And that's their mindset. And with this, our Lord, the one who cares for his followers deeply, seeks to comfort them in this very distressing time. And the first thing that he shows them, and all of us believers, is that comfort comes from trusting in his presence, knowing that he is with us. Let's take a look at verse 1 once again. Jesus says, let not your heart be troubled, and believe in God, believe also in me. Now, the last few days of the lives of the disciples have been an absolute, a crazy emotional roller coaster. Like many around, the disciples at this time didn't fully get it. They had messianic hopes that Jesus was not going to fulfill during his first coming to earth. We know Christ is coming back again, and he will do those things that the Bible tells about. He's going to come back and reign on this earth. But in his first coming, they didn't understand this, and they were expecting some things. They were hoping that Jesus would come and immediately conquer Rome. Remember, Israel was oppressed. So just think, you know, we're a blessed nation. Suppose we were under the power of China. God forbid, you know, who knows what's going to happen. But you know, say we were under the control and just realized we just shrunk down and that we could only do what they say and everything, we're losing our, you know, the church, the real church is illegal in China. Just think, you know, that's what it's like. So they're hoping, you know, that Jesus is going to come in. He's just going to conquer Rome because Rome is this big pagan superpower. So this is in their mind. So they're hoping this, you know, and some of the things that were happening might have looked like it. There was the triumphal entry. Just a week before this, you know, people are waving palm branches. Jesus is riding into town. They're shouting, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. You know, all this looks great. But then Jesus starts talking about departing, saying things like, where I am going, you cannot come. So it's changing. He talks about like how he, like wheat, has to fall to the ground and die. And the disciples, again, for a time, like the crowds, they think the Messiah is going to come in as a conquering king right there. And Jesus is a conquering king and will return. They're hoping it would come at that point in time. This is what they're hoping for. You know, someone to give it to Rome to bring a military and political victory. And the thought of Jesus dying, although he mentioned it to him before, this is hard for them to grasp. You know, I'm going to die and this is what's going on. So the disciples are extremely stressed. Now, God, Jesus is there with them during this, but they need comfort. They're really, really stressed. There's other things that add to the emotional turmoil that they're facing. We've been going through this. A lot happened in this last week, in the last couple of days. Jesus had just rebuked them for their pride. When we talked about washing, you know, Jesus washed their feet. They were prideful. So now that Jesus is going to the cross, he's just rebuked them for their prideful behavior. So they have that going through their mind. Jesus had predicted that one of the tight-knit 12 would betray him again. We know that's Judas, but then they're like, what's going on here? You know, this is quite enough to bring much distress. Jesus also told them that the strongest and their strongest leader, the boldest one of all, Peter, right? He was their unofficial leader. He was the guy. He was up there in front. They banked on him. Jesus says, you know, it's going to get rough, and you're going to deny me, Peter. You're the leader. You're their fearless leader. Well, you're going to fail. You know. So into this, into life, into all the chaos and turmoil, into this mess, Jesus is giving them comfort. He tells them, let not their hearts be troubled. And, you know, here we see the compassion of Christ. In comparison to all the false gods, that Jesus really cares for his children. Jesus really cares for us. You know, this is comforting. The creator of the universe cares. You know, and what is this comfort based in? Jesus says, you believe in God, believe also in me. Jesus is affirming his deity here. He puts himself on the same level as God the Father. He calls his disciples to put their hope in God, and Jesus being God says, look, put your trust in me. And the call for Israel has always been to put their faith in the Lord. In Psalm 25, David cries out, to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I trust in you. King Hezekiah was commended because of his faith in the Lord. It says in 2 Kings 18:5, he trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him there was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor were before him. The faith has always been what people have been called to. And faith requires that we believe without physically seeing God. And that's what faith is. We don't physically see him. True faith trusts in the presence of God even when we can't see him. This is where Jesus is going with this. Right? The disciple, Jesus is going to be leaving them. Okay? Physically, he's going to be God. And Jesus is going to tell them, no, you have my presence. Okay? And he's calling the disciples to trust him. And that's faith, trusting when we can't see God. Even when Jesus is no longer present with them, Jesus is calling for them to trust in his presence. He had told them at the end of chapter 13 he was going away. And they would not immediately go with him because he was going to go die. He was going to the cross. And, you know, so this is their mindset. Their world is crashing down around them. And, you know, Jesus is like, tell him, physically, I'm not going to be here. I'm going to leave you. His death is coming the next day. But just because he would not be physically present with them does not mean that they wouldn't receive comfort from him. Christ's promise from Hebrews 13:5 is, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And this would still hold true because the presence of the Lord is comfort. And that comfort would remain. A couple of verses after this, again in our passage, John 14:6, Jesus said, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth. And again, another helper, the Holy Spirit, another comforter. God would send his Holy Spirit to live with his disciples. And that's the promise and the hope and the comfort we have. The disciples don't know it. Jesus is leaving. He's like, I'm sending my Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God. He will be with you too. And at salvation, we receive God himself in the person of the Holy Spirit. He indwells us. You know, this is the comfort that Jesus gives to his disciples, and this is the comfort that we have. Because we all go through tough times. Some of us here are going through some very difficult things, some miserable things, some hard things. Some of us are going to, this week, something may come up. This isn't doom or gloom. This is life. But there is comfort that we have God's Holy Spirit in us. Okay, when we're distraught, we need comfort. His presence is enough to calm our troubling situation that we find ourselves in. Because we have God's Holy Spirit, we have his comforting presence. We can speak to him in prayer. He's with us. Jesus reminds the disciples here how else to be comforted. And that's by trusting in what he has prepared for them. So he's talking about the present reality of his presence. And then he does start talking about the future. And you know, we can't just live for the future. It's a both end. It's not like we just live in the present and forget about eternity, or just think about eternity and forget about the present. It's both. It's both end. We have God's presence now. We can live courageously now. We have his comfort right now. But we have a blessed future as believers. Jesus says in verses 2 and 3, and again, they could be like us. Think of us in our worst times. Life is falling apart. The disciples' life is falling apart. And Jesus says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus is promising his presence in their immediate trial, and then looks ahead to the comfort that comes from eternal life with him in heaven. Jesus said that in his Father's house there are many mansions. That word mansion is better translated as dwelling places. The NASB does that, or rooms. The NIV and the ESV translate it that way. I know this doesn't sit well with our American mindset. Do I want to rent out a room or do I want a mansion? I want a mansion, right? But that's, we kind of got to erase our American mindset right here. It misses the point, okay? Dwelling places or rooms is really, the idea is that we are a part of God's family. We're going to be in the same dwelling place as him.
Okay?
And ancient Israel, this is the way they did it, right? A father would build extra rooms in his house for his sons and their families. It might still happen over here in America, you know. Son gets married or a daughter gets married and they build onto the house and other rooms, it happens. But this is the way they did it in ancient Israel. You just build extra rooms onto the house. And you know, Jesus, this is the mindset they have. And Jesus is letting the disciples know that there's great comfort in the fact that they will be in the loving presence of their Heavenly Father for all of eternity. You know, and that's why this is better than mansions. This emphasizes the intimacy in heaven with God Himself. It's not like, oh no, where's God? He's 2 miles away up the street. He's not in my mansion. No, we're together. We're in the same dwelling place. Hey, this is the picture that Jesus is painting here. You know, and His disciples are concerned. They might not physically see Him anymore, but His Spirit is in them, and He's going to prepare a place for them. And for all of us believers, we have the same thing they do. We have God's presence with us right now. We have a glorious future. You know, He said, not only does He say that, He said, but I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. This is referring to the rapture of the church, Christ coming back, returning for His people. And it's a comforting thought in the midst of troubles that Jesus is preparing a place for us, and He's returning one day for His people. And as believers, you know, it's either we're going to die and go be with the Lord, or He's going to return and come get us. We don't know exactly when. It could be sooner than we think. Either way, it's a win-win situation. This is comfort. This is comfort for the disciples. This is comfort for us. Jesus speaks comfort some more in the next three verses. He tells the disciples, and specifically Thomas here, that comfort comes through trusting in Christ's proclamation of salvation. Verses 4 through 6 say, "And where I go you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to Him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Amen. Jesus had already told them that He was returning to the Father. But as we mentioned, this is an emotional time. There's much turmoil. They're rattled. Jesus tells them they know where He is going and the way they are going. But Thomas says, "Jesus, I don't. We don't know. We don't know where you're going. We don't know the way." You know. And as we read the Gospels and then we compare it to Acts, which is almost all of it after Jesus ascends into heaven, except for the very beginning of the first chapter, we see that the disciples often couldn't grasp what Jesus was saying at times. But in Acts, when they experienced the risen Christ, when the Holy Spirit was sent to them and they got a hold of it, they grasped the truth of what Jesus was telling all along. And here, you know, Thomas, he's not there yet. You know, Jesus gives the plain truth of the way of salvation, and Thomas is struggling to understand this. And, you know, this truth here, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." Anyone who's been around Christianity knows this is probably the number one hated verse in America today by those who are against Christianity. And the gospel is always met with hostility by world systems. Always comes against the gospel. He uses different means in different places. One of the things the devil is using in our world today is something called postmodernism. How many have heard of postmodernism? Okay, postmodernism. If you've not heard of it, you know what it is. Postmodernism is complex, but in a nutshell, here's what it is. It's a system in which people are to be skeptical of everything. It's a system in which subjective truth is given high value. That means, like, what I think really, really means a lot, and what you think really, really means a lot. And if they don't match up, that's really not such a big deal. You know, if it's true for you, it's true. If it's true for me, it's true. You know, we see this today. If someone wants to identify as something they're not, right? If they say it's true for them, then it's good enough to make it true. This is, we're in postmodern thought. We're seeing this. You can be anything you want to be if that's what you think. You know, and this thinking where everything is relative, where there's no absolute truth, is most dangerous in the world of religion or faith. Because it pushes the idea, and we might not have heard the term postmodernism, but we know it's around. What is the idea here now? All faith systems are true. They're all good. They're all right. That's what they're telling us. Does it matter? The New Ager, the one who believes in New Age mysticism, those mystical beliefs are right. Whatever they believe is correct. Hindu, if you're a Hindu, the Hindu is right. Hinduism is right. Buddhism, that's correct too. You know, if that's what you believe, then you'll be reincarnated. That's the way it works. The atheist is right as well. He believes there's no God. There's no God. God doesn't exist. And at the same time, the Mormon, whatever he believed, it doesn't matter what contradicts. This is what the world says. It's all right. And into this, Jesus says, "No, there's one way to be saved. It's through belief in me." And again, you know, this is God's word to us. There's only one way to be saved. And again, why Jesus? Why the cross? You know, why did God suffer like he did? Why did Jesus take the wrath of God, the punishment, the unimaginable pain upon himself, if we can get into heaven by following Buddha or doing some good deeds? I mean, why the cross? We can't. We can't get into heaven. And therefore, the Father loved the world so much that he sent his Son to die. Because Christ's sacrifice is the only solution for our sinfulness. So here, Jesus utters the words that the world hates, a statement that brings controversy and hostility. But for believers, this is comfort. There's comfort in this for believers. There's no wondering what path to take. I mean, the world doesn't like this, but for us believers, Jesus, the Bible doesn't leave us wondering how to get to heaven. It might be this way, it might be that way. You got to do 80% good works, or 65% good works, or this and that, or you got to be in church 51 times a year. If you miss more than one, Jesus did the work for us. There's no what comfort. There's no wondering if I'm good enough to please God. It's all done by Christ. He is the way. In the midst of life's trials, comfort comes from knowing there's only one way. There's only one path to salvation, and as believers, we took it. We put our faith in Christ. Jesus gives these words of comfort in John 10, where he says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." As we move on in verses 7 through 11, we see where else comfort comes from. Jesus said, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us." Jesus said to him, "Have you been with me so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves." Where else can the disciples find comfort? They can find it in knowing who Jesus truly is. The statement here, like verse 1 and elsewhere in John, is nothing less than a full claim to Jesus' deity that he's God. He says, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father. Also, from now on, you know him and have seen him." Jesus is reminding Philip of who he is. He is God himself in the flesh. And those cults out there, and sadly the liberal form of Christianity, which is not Christianity at all. Over and over, Jesus says things and does things that only God does, and they keep saying that Jesus isn't God. They try to Jehovah's Witnesses. The list goes on that Jesus isn't God. But if we go just the book of John alone, there's dozens and dozens of comments and things Jesus does that prove that he's God. You know, could you imagine if I said, "If you know me, you know God"? I mean, just think about that for a second. Knowing me is knowing God. I mean, you look at me, it's exactly like looking at Heavenly Father. I mean, just imagine a statement like that by a mere person. It wouldn't take too long hanging out with me to find out how wrong that statement is. But Jesus says this, right? I mean, you look at me, it's like looking at the Father. I and my Father are one, as he said. You know, so Jesus declares this truth. You know, and along with the postmodern thought here, you know, there is this attack against Christianity. It's always taken away. You know, you can believe anything you want, and we know what else is going on today. A trick of the devil. Often people will say, "Oh, Jesus was a good guy. He was a decent teacher, not God." And you know, here again, Jesus is declaring his deity. And if Jesus is the eternal God, the creator of all, the one who declares what is true and what is not true, then there is certainly power in his words of comfort here. He's the God of the universe. He's speaking to the disciples here. He's like, "I'm God. You can trust me. I can do anything." You know, comfort from him revealing that in him we are saved. You know, this is great comfort. If the world says, "Oh, Jesus was just a good philosopher," if he said, "If just some good philosopher tells me I'm saved, what good is that?" A mere man who could be wrong. But Jesus is God himself. You know, Philip's wavering here. "Show us the Father. Show us God," he's asking. And into this emotional turn aside, Jesus, let's focus on the truth here. "I am God and I am with you." Jesus rebukes Philip here, but he has patience and mercy. And he gives him a couple of reasons why he can trust Jesus. In verse 10, Jesus said, "Remember the words that I spoke." You know, no man ever spoke like Jesus. We're blessed to have his word right now in Scripture. Even unbelievers, we go through Scripture, even unbelievers admitted this. Once temple guards were sent to arrest Jesus, they returned without him. Now that's big trouble. I mean, the temple guards, if they didn't do what they were supposed to do, they can get big trouble. They can end up, you know, dead. Who knows what can happen in a time like that. But they went back to the Pharisees and said, "No man ever spoke like this man. And they wouldn't even arrest him. They weren't even believers. It is just something nobody spoke like him. Jesus tells Philip, look at my words. And in verse 11 he says, look at my works. You know, I mean, feeding multitudes of people with the 5 loaves and 2 fish, feeding thousands and thousands and thousands of people, healing the sick, the blind, raising the dead, raise Lazarus from the dead. You know, in Jesus is the power of God, because Jesus is God. In this, he's giving his disciples comfort. Look, you have God with you, and I'm not going to leave you. Jesus started off in verse 1 with the words, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He is showing the way that comfort comes in the midst of discomfort. It comes by trusting in Christ, believing in who he is, the creator and sustainer of this whole universe, who came and died for us sinners. Let's take a look at the last 3 verses as we close here. Let's look at them one more time and see what it has to say. Starting in verse 12, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will also do. And greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father, and whatever you ask in my Father's name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. You know, at first we look at this, greater works than Jesus. I mean, that sounds pretty berserk. And we will certainly not top Jesus in miracles, neither would the disciples. No one is bringing themselves back from the dead, which is Jesus did. I lay my life down and take it up again. But what Jesus is saying is that the extent of the gospel, the outreach of the disciples into the world would be greater. And this would give confidence, it would give comfort. You know, Christ's power is demonstrated as the church reaches out into the world. You know, it's a dark world out there, right? I mean, those disciples should have been destroyed in Jerusalem. They were just a little group of them. On paper, they should have been wiped out by Rome. They were just a pesky bunch, right? But there's comfort in this. Look, the church is still here today, right? Millions and millions and millions of people following Christ in a dark world. People held in bondage are pulled out of it and get saved. And, you know, right off the bat in Acts 2, by the power of the Holy Spirit, there's 3,000 converts, and the gospel spread like wildfire from Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. And again, we're here today carrying out the Great Commission, spreading the word, the gospel to the world. And, you know, this is another place we can find comfort when we're overcome by trials and tribulations in life. There's great power within us believers, within his church. There's great power. Christ left his church, but sent his Holy Spirit to indwell us. And the works of God did not stop at the cross. They're still going on to this day. And it's by his doing, his power in us. There's purpose in our lives. We have the Lord with us. So we see there's comfort in this. We're not just sitting in here dwindling down. We have no hope. There's power in a dark. We can go out into a dark world, and those people we love, even in our families, those who are close to us who are not saved, God is working, and he can save, and he can do mighty things, and we've seen the things he's done in our lives. And, you know, he's here, there's power in us, and we have the Lord with us, and he's here to help us. Jesus says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. And now we know this is in the context of the will of God. There's stuff in 1 James. We could get into this more, but just touching on it quickly. Asking anything doesn't really mean asking anything. There's a context to this. You know, you can't just ask for $1 million in fancy clothes and whatever we feel like. And but sadly, it's done in the name of Christ. But what we do know is that, you know, God is with us, and we have his power. And we have his promise to hear our call to him and to help us through. And he does provide for us, and he does give us what we need. In Philippians 4:19, Paul writes, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You know, what comfort that the God of all creation loves us and will provide for us. So we started out by talking about how we see comfort. And it's normal. It's good. We want to be comfortable. Might be things like dry socks for cold feet or whatever it is. But it runs deeper than that. You know, we need true and lasting comfort for our souls. That's what we're yearning for. And if we look to the world, we will quickly find that it's full of false hopes. That car isn't really going to bring all that comfort that it promised to bring. Only in Christ is there true and lasting comfort. And you know, Christ's message of comfort here to his disciples almost 2,000 years ago is for us today. And may we, in the midst of ever uncertain times, continue a strong trust in Christ's presence with us. In the blessed eternity we have promised in him. These things bring us comfort. May we rest each and every day in the truth that Jesus has spoken, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. We don't have to wonder where the way of salvation is. It's him. And when we put our trust in him, we've taken it. May we daily trust in who he is, fully God who came to save us. And may we also be comforted because of the power we have in us, because his Spirit indwells us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, God. We thank you for this passage we read this day, Lord. We thank you that you are the God of all comforts. You're merciful to us. We thank you, Lord, that you went to the cross for us, Lord, that we're saved by your grace. Lord, we thank you that we have the promise of your presence with us through your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. What would we do without you if you really left us, if we had no eternal hope, if we had no power of your Spirit in us, Lord? We would be lost. We would be hopeless. We could only find temporary comfort in the things of the world, things that pass away, Lord. But we have eternal comfort in you. We have the best comfort, the only true, lasting comfort. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus, that by way of the cross, you made that way to us. Thank you that you laid down your life for us. And Lord, I pray that you would work in each one of us. I know, starting with myself, there's much reason for anxiety. We look to the left, we look to the right, we look up, we look down, we look in front of us, we look behind us, and there's always something lingering around. And Lord, I just pray, God, that we would keep our eyes on you. You are the one who brings true comfort, Lord. We just thank you for that, that you love us so much. We thank you for your compassion and your mercy and your love. And Lord, I just pray your blessing of comfort on each and every one of us right now and as we go from this place and this week. And we commit this week to you, Lord. May we live for you. May we live in light of you. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay.